Part 2 begins on page 355 in the Book of Common Prayer. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open. All desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Reading from Joshua. Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem and summoned the elders, the heads, the judges, and the officers of Israel, and they presented themselves before God. And Joshua said to all the people, "Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, long ago your ancestors, Terah and his sons Abraham and Nahor, lived beyond the Euphrates and served other gods. Then I took your father Abraham from beyond the river and led him through all the land of Canaan and made his offspring many. Now, therefore, revere the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in faithfulness. Put away the gods that your ancestors served beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. Now, if you are unwilling to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your ancestors served in the region beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord." Then the people answered, "Far be it from us that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods. For it is the Lord our God who brought us and our ancestors up from the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, and who did these great signs in our sight. He protected us along all the way that we went, and among all the peoples through whom we passed. And the Lord drove out before us all the peoples, the Amorites who lived in the land. Therefore, we also will serve the Lord, for he is our God." But Joshua said to the people, you cannot serve the Lord, for he is a holy God. He is a jealous God. He will not forgive your transgressions or your sins. If you forsake the Lord and serve foreign gods, then he will turn and do you harm and consume you after having done you good. And the people said to Joshua, "No, we will serve the Lord." Then Joshua said to the people, "You are witnesses against yourselves that you have chosen the Lord to serve him." And they said, "We are witnesses." He said, "Then put away the foreign gods that are among you and incline your hearts to the Lord, the God of Israel." The people said to Joshua, "The Lord our God we will serve, and him we will obey." So Joshua made a covenant with the people that day and made statutes and ordinances for them at Shechem. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 78 is found on page 694 of the prayer book. Let's read verses 1 through 7 responsibly by whole verse. "Hear my teaching, O my people. Incline your ears to the words of my mouth.
I will open my mouth in parable. I will declare the mysteries of ancient times.
That which we have heard and known, and what our forefathers have told us, we will not hide from their children.
We will recount to generations to come the praiseworthy deeds and the power of the Lord, and the wonderful works he has done.
He gave his decrees to Jacob and established a law for Israel, which he commanded them to teach their children.
That the generations to come might know, and the children yet unborn, that they in their turn might tell it to their children.
So that they might put their trust in God and not forget the deeds of God, but keep his commandments. Amen." The second reading for today is from Thessalonians. "We do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about those who have died, so that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have died. For this we declare to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will by no means precede those who have died. For the Lord himself, with the cry of command, with the archangel's call, and the sound of God's trumpet, will descend from heaven, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up in the clouds together with them to meet the Lord in the air, and so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
for Christ. Jesus said, the kingdom of heaven will be like this. 10 bridesmaids took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. When the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them. But the wise took flasks of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, all of them became drowsy and slept. But at midnight there was a shout, "Look, here is the bridegroom. Come out to meet him." Then all those bridesmaids got up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out." The wise replied, "No, there will not be enough for you and for us. You had better go to the dealers and buy some for yourselves." And while they went to buy it, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went with him into the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the other bridesmaids came also, saying, "Lord, Lord, open to us." But he replied, "Truly, I tell you, I do not know you. Keep awake, therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
I invite the children to follow us for the children's homily. Find my bridesmaids' figurines this morning, so we're just going to have a little talk. Do you guys know what it's like to prepare for something? You do? What is something that you prepare for? You get ready for it. But what's something in particular that you have to prepare and get ready for? Get your stuff ready for what? If you're leaving your house, you got to get your stuff ready. Second base instead of first base. You do these things over and over again, right? How come?
Because it's different
plays. Many different plays. And then soccer, what do you practice? You practice passing your teammates, and kicking it into the goal. Because baseball and soccer, they're both pretty fast sports, aren't they? Do you have time when the ball is passed to you in soccer to think about what you're going to do next? Do you have time when the ball's coming to say, "I wonder what I'm going to do"? You stand there and scratch your head and think about it. What's going to happen?
Somebody's going to steal.
Someone's going to take the ball from you, right? And what happens if you do that in baseball? The ground ball is hit your way and you stop to think about, okay, how do I do this?
It'll get past you.
It'll go by you. Practice and preparation prepares you so that when the time comes, you know immediately what you're supposed to do. You don't really even have to think about it. When the ball's kicked to you in soccer, you know where you're going next. If you're going to pass it, run with it, try to score. And those sports teach you to prepare and be ready for when it comes in the real moment, then you can do it without thinking. So how can we apply this to our lives as Christians? How do you prepare to, like, love your neighbor, for example? These are harder questions, aren't they? That's part of the reason we're all here today, because all of us try to love our neighbor together. Juliana's not here, right? Okay, we are missing some people. But we practice here at church, we practice how to ask for forgiveness and how to offer forgiveness, so that when we leave, you don't have to stop and scratch your head about, oh, should I forgive this person or not? I've already forgiven them like 5 or 6 times for being a big bully. But you learn in here to practice those kind of things. And how do we prepare to live like God does rule the world, but how do we prepare to enter into His kingdom? Learned those things in here. We're here practicing and preparing so that we can go out and live lives without having to think really hard about what it means to follow Jesus. So think about that the next time you're practicing your piano or kicking a soccer ball or taking a ground ball for the 100th time. That all these things prepare you to be good in the moment. And coming to church and reading our Bible, being together with all of these people, these help us to follow Jesus when we leave this place. Amen. Here are your worship bulletins for this morning. Children and I have just spent some time reflecting on preparation. To be prepared for something, it is important to consider how you spend your time. If you let time simply pass away without any thought or action towards how your time is spent, you're not going to be left with very much. Now, I don't think that today people are any less tempted than they may have been in previous times, but I think to kind of illustrate this point, the technology available today helps us to see how we can be tempted to pass time rather than to think about how we spend time. So think about like the endless options for consuming media. There's countless subscription services you can have. You can have Disney Plus and Netflix, and you kind of sit there and watch your shows. There's YouTube, that there's a rabbit hole, you know, you go to like watch one thing and an hour goes by and you're, you know, looking up a video about World War II or something, and that's not what you went to YouTube for. Our sports seasons are even longer than they were when I was growing up. And there's all these streaming options now. You can watch football all the time. Baseball's easily at hand. And then there's the social media where people, you know, can scroll your Facebook. I don't think you can ever get to the bottom of the Facebook feed. You keep scrolling and seeing what people are doing. And there's even content creators now that's available to even younger children or anybody. You're able to like create your own content and put it online. And you begin thinking about, well, how is your life worthy to be recorded? How is it going to be viewed by someone else? Now, I'm not trying to blame younger people, because older people gave them all this stuff, right? So there's some responsibility there. But I wonder, what is life beyond that camera lens? Is time just something to be consumed, to be on a feed or a video? Or is time to be used and spent to pursue holiness? Now, Wendell Berry has written about a similar distinction with work. And he writes that the nearly intolerable irony in our dissatisfaction with work is that we've removed pleasure from our work in order to remove drudgery from our lives. And if I, speaking as Wendell Berry, if I could pick any rule of industrial economics to receive a thorough re-examination by our people, it would be the one that says all hard physical work is drudgery and not worth doing. And he goes on to tell these stories about the tobacco harvest in his community. And maybe many of you have memories from your childhood where the community gathered, maybe not to harvest tobacco, but to build a barn or to be together, or think about Thanksgiving dinner and how that usually is a family event to prepare and cook all that food. Now, with the tobacco harvest, it's something that Wendell Berry participated in since being a child. And he recognizes that there are problems with tobacco, but that experience of harvesting tobacco for Berry is the only remaining farm work in his area that involves traditional neighborliness. Now, the tobacco harvest is difficult. It's physically demanding. It happens in the hottest part of the year, in late August to early October. And unpredictable weather can make it an emergency. You got to get it done before the weather comes in. Now, because the work has been done by hand for many generations, it's retained much of its original form. Now, Berry notes that cutting tobacco can be a drudgery if there's too much of it, there's too much work. The work could go on too long. You may not enjoy doing it, or you may not enjoy the company of the people you're with. Then yes, that would be a drudgery. But for Berry and those he worked with, they never experienced it as that. The work isn't always pleasurable, but they did take pleasure in it. That community gathered for many weeks. Day after day, they were together, families and neighbors in the fields. Without machines, the work wasn't noisy. And they were able to talk and reminisce, be with each other, and hear their conversations. The work spanned generations. So the older generation who knew how to work efficiently was working side by side with the younger generation who had the body that was able to work fast and efficiently, and they learned from each other. When there was work to be done in someone's particular field, you could recall the memory of someone's grandfather or grandmother who also was there in that field many years ago. Also in this work, there was the children. And Berry writes that as industrial work excludes the dead by social mobility and technological change, it excludes children by haste and danger. The children are around the work, just being children. But they may come and play the adults' work, and they may come to know and work the land themselves. And having children around playing gives adults the chance to play and make a joke and maybe not take themselves so seriously. So in the face of this challenging task, Wendell Berry suggests that pleasure is all that you can offer. In this close-knit community where the economics of every family is dependent on another family or on their neighbor, they each take and offer pleasure with one another. And this kind of community doesn't miss the past or fear what's coming in the future because their present is so full and it is enough to keep them together. So let us begin to connect this with the gospel lesson. Remember last week we heard the Beatitudes? These were some of Jesus' earliest teachings. Today's parable is one right before his death. This is one of the last three in the Gospel of Matthew. Now, a lot of time has passed between the Sermon on the Mount and before Jesus' crucifixion. Now, remember, the Beatitudes describe a community. It's a community centered around the Blessed One. Jesus is the only one who embodies all of the Beatitudes. And his body, the church, points to him by having all of those characteristics present. And we know that we're going to be a community pointing to Christ when we have the poor and the mournful and the meek and those who hunger for righteousness. When those people are among us, we will know we're the body of Christ. And Jesus gathers around him people who witness those characteristics. Now, to me, the Beatitudes seem like a message of inclusion, right? They're open for anyone. The kingdom of heaven belongs to those whom the world offers little dignity or value. And Jesus calls those blessed. Now, on the other hand, we have today's parable. The parable of the wise and foolish bridesmaids, who, on initial glance, kind of seems like a message of exclusion. Jesus tells them from the beginning that five are wise and five are foolish. But how else are you to know? Except that Jesus tells us. All ten are dressed exactly the same way. They've all come to meet the bridegroom. So by their outward appearance, they're all the same. The only difference is the oil they brought. The foolish do not bring any extra, while the wise have brought flasks. They must have been Episcopalians. The wise have enough oil and are prepared for a long wait. And the foolish only have enough oil for their own timetable. The wise are ready for life in the kingdom, and they display readiness. They're even prepared for a long delay. But it's not till late at night that we learn who is wise and who is foolish. Remember Jesus' previous call for watchfulness? If the owner of the house had known in what part of the night the thief was coming, he would have stayed awake. He would not have let his house be broken into. For that call comes at midnight. The bridegroom is on his way. And the wise bridesmaids rebuff the foolish ones when they plead for their oil. No, there's not going to be enough for both of us. You better go buy some yourselves. What kind of party or celebration would it be in the dark? Their light is necessary to welcome the bridegroom. And the bridegroom comes, and for those who are ready, they go to the banquet and the party, and the door is shut. And the other bridesmaids eventually come along and seek to get in. And the bridegroom says, "Truly, I do not know you." This narrative may not only feel unfair, it seems to kind of go against what we heard in the Beatitudes. The wise bridesmaids aren't sharing their oil. However, let's try to see how the Beatitudes and this parable are connected. How are they part of the same gospel? This parable of the wise and foolish bridesmaids teaches us the virtue of readiness. To be prepared, you have to have enough oil for the long wait. And when the bridegroom comes, the wise will have been prepared, and there will be light for everyone to celebrate. The call to prepare is the inclusion. Everyone is welcome to gather the oil necessary to prepare for the kingdom. In order to live lives of charity and compassion, we have to be prepared. While we are welcoming one stranger together, there's going to be another stranger and another poor person knocking at the door the next day. And only a community that's prepared and ready for the bridegroom is going to endure this time with charity. So this story of Wendell Berry and his experience with the tobacco harvest, I think, helps us illumine the parable of the bridesmaids, because it raises some important questions. What are we to do with the time given to us? Is it time to merely be passed? Or do we spend the time in cultivation of virtue and holiness and character? This work at times can be difficult. It may sometimes be a drudgery. But every Sunday we gather together. It's not unlike those who gather together for a tobacco harvest. We get together to talk, to hear God's word, to share in the breaking of Christ's body, and the spilling of his blood. We seek to do the hard work of the kingdom together here every week. We embrace the stories and places of our past, but we do not grieve as others do who have no hope. Now, the early church understood the oil in this parable to be a symbol of good works done in charity. And the church prepares for the bridegroom by works of compassion. The church, where we are today, it's a hospital for sinners. It's a school for the saints. Foolish people may come along and rejoice at Jesus' miraculous work, but eventually foolish people aren't interested in the more mundane day-to-day offering of their life back to God. Foolish people do not practice compassion, and therefore they're not ready when the bridegroom returns. Christ calls us all to his glorious wedding banquet. So may we all share together in the work of preparation. May our lamps burn brightly for others as we ready ourselves for the one who is the way, the truth, and the life. Amen. Standing, let us affirm our faith with the Nicene Creed on page 358. We believe in one God.
Prayers of the people are found on page 387. We'll be using form 3. Father, we pray for your Holy Catholic Church.
That we all may be one.
Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you.
That your name may be glorified by all people.
We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons, especially Justin, Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, our presiding bishop, Sam and Jennifer, our bishops, and Joe, our vicar.
That they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments.
We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world.
That there may be justice and peace on the earth.
Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
That our works may find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
That they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let light perpetual shine upon them.
We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others. Turning to St. Andrew's prayer list, we pray for
Jimmy Griffin, Sandy Marks, Jim Jeffries, Brenda Signore, Joy and Carly Cartoy, Shane Cartoy, Peggy Dance, Danny Thomas, Danny Whitted, and David Miriam.
And others for whom our prayers are desired,
Bishop Michael Curry, and Reverend Gabe Amazon.
Hasten, O Father, the coming of your kingdom, and grant that we, your servants who now live by faith, may behold with joy thy Son and his coming in glorious majesty, even Jesus Christ, our only mediator and advocate. Amen. On page 360, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God,
we confess we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Please stand. My brothers and my sisters, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Welcome to St. Andrew's Episcopal Church. I'm Joe Sroka, the vicar here. If I haven't had a chance to meet you yet and you're new, please introduce yourself this morning. After service this morning, we'll have refreshments and coffee in the parish hall. Everyone's invited to come and have a bite to eat and share some fellowship with one another. We look forward to catching up and having some conversation this morning. Also this evening at 5 o'clock is our healing service. I invite you back for that, for a time of quiet. It's going to be dark this evening, so the candles in the church, I think, are going to look really nice and be really peaceful this evening. So invite you back for the healing service at 5 o'clock. Are there any other announcements from the church? Walk in love as Christ loved us. He gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Amen.
Great Thanksgiving on page 367. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on the first day of the week overcame death in the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father,
we remember his death,
we proclaim his resurrection,
we await his coming in glory.
We offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son and his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, Saint Andrew and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us.
Save us from the time of trial, but deliver us from evil.
Thine is the kingdom,
power, and glory, now and forever. Amen.
take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us the spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Amen.
Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always.
Amen.